Gustavo Garcia is a prisoner in Texas. If the state has its way, he'll be dead within the hour. This is Execution Watch. Huntsville, Texas, death penalty capital of the Western world, where prison staff is preparing to put Garcia to death by injecting him with a deliberate drug overdose. During the next hour, KPFT's Execution Watch will broadcast live coverage of the killing in Texas, the state responsible for nearly half of all U.S. executions. Execution Watch host Ray Hill, Chief Legal Analyst Jim Skelton, with Legal Analysts Larry Douglas, Jack Lee, Mike Gillespie, and Paige Yannick. Huntsville reporter outside the death house, Pat Hartwell. Houston Vigil reporter, Dave Atwood. Tonight's show will include an interview with Garcia, conducted 2 weeks ago on death row. The execution watch for Gustavo Garcia begins.
Good evening, this is Ray Hill. We are listening to KPFT HD2 channel. We're on high definition, and many of you have tuned in either by www.kpft.org, HD2 channel, or by executionwatch.org. Tonight, Gustavo Garcia is being executed. We're waiting word for Huntsville. There's a telephone call coming in. And Pat.
Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, not very well, but I can hear you. The media witnesses have walked across. The family is here, but none have chosen to witness as per Gus's wishes.
Okay, you're out there with all of the family?
Yes, it's a very large family. We've got one family member, which is an aunt, that can say a few words if you would like.
Would you put her on?
Okay.
Hello?
Yes, ma'am. Who are you?
My name is Rose, and I am Gustavo Garcia's aunt. We have exhausted our efforts to try this manslaughter going on in Huntsville. For any government in Texas, they will never get a vote from me unless the government who believes in not, who does not believe in the death penalty. God bless each and every one of them, and I hope they sleep well tonight without looking into the incident or the age of this Gustavo Garcia at the time of the accident. He was actually 17 years old and not what the media says that he was 19. But again, everything's a cover up. But all I can say is that he will be in heaven with the Lord.
Well, all we can say is give the rest of the family our sympathy.
Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you, ma'am. Bye-bye. And that was Gustavo's aunt. And so the family is up there. Pat said the witnesses have all crossed the road. There are no family witnesses, which is unusual. There's a bunch of them up there, but they didn't choose to go in and watch the execution, and that kind of makes sense. Jim, while we're waiting on Dave to call in, what happened in this case?
You know, when I first read about this case, I think of a special they had on PBS, I think it's PBS, about the Loeb Leopold case back in the 20s when two young men about the same age, real brilliant, came from wealthy families, killed a young kid just to see if they could get away with the crime. And later bragged about it and were very proud of themselves for doing it. And during the trial, when Clarence Darrow defended him, they kept giggling, making fun of everybody. And there was a big outcry in that case to kill them, hang them. And they tried the case in front of the judge. And what happened, Darrow had the money because both families were very wealthy, present a lot of evidence. But the judge eventually came around and said he would give them life sentences. And the major reason he did, because of their age. Because he just could not see somebody in the young 18 or 19 years old letting that control their entire life. And here's what happened in this case. This was an 18-year-old kid, but then another guy named Christopher Vargas, they did a robbery of a liquor store. And what happened, he took a clerk back in the back room and shot him in the stomach with a shotgun. In fact, when he goes in the store, he has a sawed-off shotgun with plenty of ammunition, single-shot shotgun. Shoots him in the stomach, and the clerk threw a chair at him and tried to escape. Garcia chased him down and shot him in the back of the head and killed him. And then about a month later, the same two go to a Texaco service station, and when they walk in, the clerk is on the phone talking to his girlfriend. He knows he's going to be robbed, so he said, ask the girlfriend to call 911. And they did basically the same thing. They took the clerk to the back room, and Garcia shot him in the back of the head at point blank with a shotgun. And by the time he finished that, the police had arrived, and they arrested him at the scenes. And he ended up giving a confession, so the question of guilt was never, ever a problem. And again, and I think a lot of people would agree with this, that it's horrible to think that your entire life can be controlled by decisions you made when you're 18 or 19 years old. Of course, the Supreme Court recognized that you can't execute people under 17, but 18 apparently is free game. And nonetheless, he was 40-something years. I mean, he's 40-something years old now.
Yeah, he's 42, and he's spent
almost half his life on death
over
row.
Over half of his life.
Yeah, at least half of his life on death row. And
I interviewed him, and the interview will be later in the show, but basically you're going to find him to be a soft-spoken guy, kind of resolved to his current situation. And I want to encourage people to see that on Houston Media Source, because the visual of that interview is pretty powerful stuff.
He looks like a nice-looking young man in the photographs of him.
Yeah, well, he got a little gray scattered through his temple. He is matured, but he's not the same guy that did the rousing and the killing.
Nope.
And I take it from the shuffle of the headphones and the microphone that our next one up is Paige. Paige, what's your piece of the puzzle?
Well, I'm here to talk about the punishment hearing in the Capitol trial.
There were actually two.
Yes, indeed. But I'm going to speak as to the first punishment hearing.
Okay.
And then Jack Lee will address the issue around the second punishment hearing.
Okay.
In any event, we had in this original trial all of the factual evidence which was introduced at guilt or innocence.
Yeah.
And since guilt was absolutely a slam dunk, it was all whether or not he was a continuing threat to society and whether or not the murder was deliberate and based upon his actions, he must have thought that the reasonable result was going to be death.
Yeah.
The facts, as Jim has outlined them, are a little incomplete, and so I'm going to expand. It came out in the trial that Mr. Garcia had gone to this liquor store with Mr. Vargas, and that when they went in there, he told Vargas to get some beer and sent Vargas back to the vehicle.
Yeah.
That he took the clerk into the back room and shot him either the stomach or someplace in the abdominal area. And then the clerk had grabbed a chair in the room. He got up from his kneeling position, grabbed the chair in the room, and threw it at Garcia and made his escape. He ran out of the store, behind the back of the store, went over a fence, and is in a lot behind the store when Garcia catches up to him, puts him back down on his knees, and shoots him in the back of the head. So,
and that's the case they tried.
That's the case they tried. And all of these things, the fact that the shotgun was sawed off, the fact that he came with extra ammunition, and it was shown in Guilt and Innocence also that he talked after the murder to a person who was at Vargas's house before they left, and who was still there when they returned back with beer and money from the liquor store. And Garcia said that he took the money, got the beer, shot the clerk, and left. And he said the reason he shot the clerk, he told Mr. Flores, it was Bobby Flores, that he killed the clerk in order to avoid being identified later as the person who committed the robbery. So all of this has come out in Guilt and Innocence. And when you get to punishment and you're talking about whether or not the action was deliberate with a reasonable expectation of death, I mean,
yeah, it's the jigsaw puzzle comes together.
Yeah, that is a pretty obvious issue for the jury to consider. And then the jury starts talking about whether or not there's a reasonable probability that Garcia would constitute a future danger to society. Well, coincidentally, while he was out after committing the first murder, within, like as Jim mentioned, within a month, less than a month, he has gone to a stop and go,
yeah,
and robbed that clerk, killed that clerk as well.
Same basic MO.
Absolutely. Shotgun to the back of the head, beer. And he had even sent Vargas back out to the car with the beer in the second murder. So this has come out, and at punishment, whether, you know, it becomes obvious that it was calculated, that he spent thought and time on trying to achieve the result of the robbery and the beer at the same time. And the only issues where we might have had something that would have swayed a jury in his favor would have been age. You know, whether or not he was able to appreciate the severity of his actions. We consider that now in capital cases.
Well, but do you know whether the defense offered any of that?
No, sir, I do not. Having read the record in this case as opposed to having attended the trial.
Yeah.
I can just offer what is in the record, and that is what the appellate courts look at as well.
Okay, and speaking of the appeals, I suppose this case was appealed.
Yes.
We forgot one thing about that. The testimony as to future dangerousness was made by special witness.
Indeed, and that is what Jack Lee is going to talk about.
Okay.
Okay. Mike is going to address the other issues concerning punishment as well.
Okay. When we shift headphones and speak around. Dave, is that Dave? Hello?
Yes.
David?
Hello. Is it Dave?
Okay.
Okay,
it's Dave Atwood. Dave, where are you?
I'm outside of St. Stephen's Church.
Okay, you got a little daylight this time. It's been dark out there.
No, it's okay. It's not dark yet. It's okay. It's a very nice evening to be outside. Too bad we're out here for such a sad cause, actually.
How many vigilants you got?
We got 5 people here today, Ray.
Okay.
Not that many, but these are our sturdy members that are here for every vigil.
Oh, those are the stalwarts.
Yep, these are the stalwarts, and they're here, you know, through what, no matter what the weather is, they come out, which is really great. So we've got, as normal, I think, you know, we've had so many executions, it's really, some people get discouraged and they don't want to come out so much, but we do have our stalwarts that will come out no matter what.
Dave, one interesting thing about the Huntsville vigil is that it's almost all family. No one from the family chose to go in and watch the killing.
Oh, boy.
But they're all gathered up outside. And
And I can understand the not wanting to go in. I mean, I can understand that. That would be, unless the person who's being executed requests it specifically. I mean, it's a horrible, horrible thing to see. I mean, just to have your loved one put to death right before your eyes. I mean, that can't. There's nothing worse than that. And so I can understand how they might not want to do that.
One aunt was actually on the show. The other thing that I wanted to mention about, you've got a conference coming up?
We do, Ray. It's this weekend on Saturday. It's at Unity Church. It starts in the morning. I think you got to start serving some breakfast around 8. If people want to come, they can actually come out there. And if they haven't registered, you can register still online. But if you haven't and you're not sure about your schedule, you can come out that morning. Or you can just come for the lunch. The whole schedule, I believe, is on the TC80P website. And that's when we give out the awards, which includes, of course, this year, KPFT receiving an award because of this show, Execution Watch, and the prison show, you know, having a report on the death penalty. So,
well, I think Elizabeth and I are going to be showing up on behalf of the Execution Watch because fearless leader Dwayne wanted us to come out for the luncheon.
Well, that's wonderful, Ray. That's wonderful. I think it'll be it's always a great day. You know, anybody knows, this is really extremely hard work with a lot of discouragement. So this is a time when you can get pumped up a little bit and realize that you're not by yourself. There's a lot of people working on this issue and more and more coming every day. I mean, every time you turn around, there's somebody else, another legislator, another person who's been in politics, you know, a number of people come out, and the movement is growing, and it's getting stronger all the time. And we know we've been, you know, you wouldn't think that with all the executions Texas has, but we know that overall the war is being won. And so it's
Dave,
a wonderful event to come to.
Well, I've got you on the phone. Justice Scalia has died.
Right.
And we're getting pretty close to a critical balance on the Supreme Court, aren't we?
Yes, definitely. Well, you've got, you know, until somebody else is appointed, you've got four progressives, and you've got four people who are looked at as conservatives, but one of them, Justice Kennedy, sometimes votes right. And so if something came up right now, we could have a good outcome. And so
in one of Scalia's last speeches, he said that he was of the opinion that the death penalty is on weak legs.
Yep. I think he's right. We can just see the trend. You know, the trend is very clear.
Well, is that website again, please?
Okay, it's TCADP.org.
And TCADP is an acronym to Texas
Coalition to Abolish the Death Penalty, right?
Thank you, Dave.
Okay, Ray, thank you. You take care.
Okay, bye-bye. That was Dave Atwood out on the scene, and there's nothing going to happen to Antonin Scalia that's going to affect what's going on with Gustavo Garcia. Jack, you're going to talk to me about why
expert witness.
Why expert witness, right?
The state of Texas on several occasions hired an expert witness by the name of Walter Quijano, and to testify as to the future dangerousness of defendants. And this Walter Quijano gets on the stand, and he starts talking about how blacks and Hispanics were more inclined for future dangerousness, for various reasons, were more inclined to be dangerous. And, well, make a long story short, that was taken up by the Supreme Court in Saldano v. Texas, and Supreme Court basically said, you really can't make these kinds of race-based conclusions, and that it's prejudicial. So they overturned that, and as a result of this, Garcia got a second punishment hearing.
But that was in a bunch. There were several of those.
Oh, there were several. I don't remember the exact number, but there were a bunch of them that were all overturned, and all of these cases had to get a second sentencing hearing. Five of them. I've been told there were five.
Five of them.
Yeah.
And did any of that have any effect on any of the cases that you know of?
That I know of, no. Certainly in this case, in Garcia, it didn't have it didn't make any difference at all.
Okay, now, when was the second hearing on sentencing in relation to the escape attempt?
In relation to the escape attempt, I believe...
Because I think that Jack Gillespie is going to talk about... Mike Gillespie is going to talk about that.
It was a couple of years afterwards.
So in the ensuing time... Garcia tried to escape.
Tried to escape.
With Guruli.
Sure.
And so by the time they got around to the second sentencing, they had more coals for the fire.
It doesn't really help. You've been an inmate for several years, and three years before you try to escape, that doesn't help on a future dangerousness
argument.
In
reading these cases, did you find anything that the defense lawyers didn't do that they could have?
I've said this before. I'll keep saying this. The defense lawyers on capital cases are almost always as good as they come. They, at trial, they come up with good defensive strategies that, frankly, they're trying to do the best out of a bad case.
Yeah.
And...
You got to catch them as they come. You can't...
Well...
You can't put lipstick on these pigs.
Exactly. And... Then when it comes on, and then when it comes to comes up for appeal, well, what do you appeal on a trial record that is actually pretty good, where the defense did everything they possibly could have? You don't really have a whole lot to appeal, so you do think so you come up with ridiculous arguments, and you always throw in ineffective assistance of counsel, sure. Even though at trial
it's just
you had
a grab bag issue.
It's you're throwing everything at it that you possibly can. You've got nothing to hold on to. You're throwing the kitchen sink at it.
Okay, I'm going to let Mike get around there, but I think now we need to hear from Gus. You got Gus tuned up? Mm-hmm. Here we go. Gustavo Garcia.
Correct. Gustavo Julian Garcia.
Julian.
Yeah.
Julian.
Uh-oh.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who is that guy? Tell me about Gustavo.
Well, I'm a convict. As you say, right? I mean, I've spent more than half my life in prison. I was arrested 8 months, 4 months after my 18th birthday. And so most of my life has been spent here on death row.
On this case?
On death row.
In other words, you had just 4 months.
After my 18th birthday.
After your 18th birthday.
I was arrested.
If this had happened 5 months before, you wouldn't be here.
Correct.
Because the Supreme Court said you can't do
juveniles
that.
Juveniles are not to be executed, right?
Yeah. And what you, I'm working right now because why 18? What is special about 18?
It's just a number. You know, you've got to start somewhere.
Science says your brain is not fully developed until you're in 22, 23.
21, yeah, something like that.
Yeah. 21 is still a little bit arbitrary.
Correct. Yeah, so it's just a number, something to start with.
Yeah, I mean, makes it easy for them.
Yes, correct.
Not necessarily for you.
Right. Yeah, there's nothing saying they couldn't extend it to 19 or 20.
Okay, so you didn't have an adult life prior to getting locked up.
No, 4 months.
You grew up in prison.
Yeah, basically, yes. Yeah. And, before then, I'd been to juvenile twice. I'd been to a boys' home, to a drug rehab. So most of my formative years were locked up.
Where are you from?
McKinney. Yes, it's 30 miles north of Dallas.
Okay. All
right. That's basically the story of my life.
You
death
got
row.
Family?
Huh?
You got family?
Yes.
Who comes see you?
My mom, my sisters. Mainly that's it, but that's all I need, right? That's been my strength.
Yeah.
And that's it. You know, I mean,
Well, what was it like being a kid? Because I'm looking at you now, and you actually, except for the little gray snow on the side of your head, look younger than your years.
Yeah, well, 43, yeah.
43.
Yeah, well, I mean, I was average kid, you know, I mean.
You must have looked like a baby when you were 18.
Well, I was a late bloomer. Yeah, I was a late bloomer. I was always, looked young, but, yeah, I was an average kid. No different than anybody else.
So the other family you had were your brothers on the road?
Yeah. A lot of them, a lot of them been executed.
And we probably have some mutual friends.
Oh, yeah, without a doubt, without a doubt. You've done interviews with several of them.
I worry most about Pruitt.
Yeah, he's over there now on execution, on death watch.
Give him my regards when you get back, if you get a chance. I know that's a pretty isolated place.
Yeah, I'll give him a holler. I mean, other than that, I mean, I know nothing else about living out in the world, right?
Yeah, you're right. you didn't get that opportunity.
Yeah, and like I said, you know, and then before I got locked up here, I was in juvenile and boys' home and drug rehab, and so.
That's a mess, too.
Yeah. When I tell people, I tell them, you know, basically I've had about 4 or 5 years out in the world that actually meaningful years that you know, as a teenager, you know, somebody with some freedom to move around and just basically get in trouble.
Old enough for a bicycle, not quite for a car.
Right. Yeah.
All right. If I told you that 40,000 people are going to look this show up from all over the world.
Correct.
And this is your opportunity to talk to them.
Right.
It's also what your family will hold on to.
Right.
After this horrible thing happens.
Right.
And you know, I get calls almost every week from mothers saying thanking me for the laughter. So find something to laugh about.
Yeah.
Your mother will appreciate it.
Yeah, hey, laughter is what keeps us going in here, right? A lot of times, you know, you gotta laugh and enjoy life. You know, you take it moment by moment, right? And that's the way we do it. I mean, that's the way I do it. You got to live, but to maintain your sanity. You know, sometimes the isolation can get to you, and so you have to communicate. You have to laugh, holler at your neighbor, get him out the bunk, and.
Yeah, because he may be,
he might be in a similar situation.
You know, he needs help.
Yeah, so you got to help each other out, right?
Yeah.
And
these people raised you.
Well, they.
After you were 18. You had a family before, but after you turned about 18, guys on the row were brother, sister, uncle, and a lot of times parents.
Well, there were a few people who actually had a major influence on my life here, right? But for the most part, I raised myself. You know, I was, like I said, 18. I was uneducated, eighth grade dropout. I really didn't know anything about anything, but I thought I knew everything.
You articulate yourself very well.
I've raised myself and I've educated myself for many of these years. I got my GED while I was here on death row. Mm-hmm. I took a paralegal course. Got a paralegal certificate for whatever that's worth. I know something about the law that's helped me to understand what's the process that I'm going through, that's it. You know, I do a lot of reading.
Is there anything at all happening in your case at this point?
Not really. I mean, the attorneys I've got, they're the same attorneys that represented Raphael Holiday.
Okay.
That know, they basically helped have him executed. And
why don't you have some choice in that? Well, why don't you have some choice in who's your lawyer?
And that's interesting, you know, especially when it comes down to the end, like where I'm at now, you know, you can't just get rid of your attorneys. You can request that they be dismissed. You can request the courts to remove them. They can even file a motion with the courts asking to be removed from your case, but a lot of times the courts will refuse it because their thinking is they don't want to inject any error into the case by removing the attorneys. They want to maintain a valid judgment, in their words.
In other words, everything is
they want to keep the status quo so that there's nothing.
Preserve what's going to happen.
Right. They don't want to cause any error to give you a stay. And so, I have no say. You know, I've tried for over a year now, trying to get rid of these attorneys, and there's nothing doing. Yeah. And I think that's something that's wrong with the system. You know, one of the many things wrong with the system. That we have no say in that, have no control over that.
You know, 10 days is not a long time.
A little over 10 days, yeah, not much, but try not to focus on that. I just, like I said, you know, I'm living day by day.
There's
right?
always that last minute, I call it a game of chicken, where they throw everything at the wall and hope something sticks, and almost always nothing does. You went through that the last process.
Well, these attorneys aren't doing anything. I've got the Innocence Network, David Dow and Jeff Newberry. They're trying to do something. They should be filing something maybe yesterday or today or tomorrow. Like you said, you know, it's that last minute, you know, trying to find something. They're working on it. Hopefully they can make something happen, but you know, it's the old convict mentality, you know, expect the worst, hope for the best. Yeah. And that's all I can do.
I remember being locked down.
Right.
I've been dead in that 160-year sentence. I didn't think there was any hope.
Right. And you actually did 4 years?
Well, I filed an Eighth Amendment writ and found me a sucker federal judge, and he said, well, we settled this by agreement, so there's nothing to appeal.
What?
Forced the state down, and they changed 20 consecutive eight-year sentences to 20 concurrent eight-year sentences. And as a trustee, I had been getting 2-for-1 time credits. Got out in 4 years, 4 months, and 17 days. Scared to death.
Right. So, what are your thoughts on the death penalty?
It's an anachronism. It belongs to a different era. It doesn't belong in a modern world. In a modern world, we like to depend on science and technology and logic. And death penalty is just a thing that's out of its time and out of its place. It's a throwback to a superstitious time. And I think most of the criminal justice system is not about correction, helping people get out. It's about revenge. It's over and over and over again. That's so ugly.
Right. Well, you know the old saying, you know, absolute power corrupts absolute.
Well, you don't get more absolute than I got the right of life or death.
And that's one of the reasons that I disagree with the death penalty myself, right, is that, you know, it's too easy for people to manipulate the system and to have someone executed who's innocent. And I'm not claiming to be innocent. I'm not going to...
Yeah, but you've known people on the road.
Yes, I've known people on the road.
That were sweating down a day.
Yeah.
And then they're innocent. I mean, Anthony Graves and I do a lot of work together.
Yeah.
And you remember when he was on the road?
Yeah, I remember Anthony Graves. I remember his supposed to be fall partner, the one that implicated him and actually got him on death row. It was actually me and a couple of other guys that actually convinced him to speak out against what he was doing, because he'd embraced Christianity. He'd turned his life over. He'd become saved, and he approached us as a group, and told us what had happened, and we convinced him, or we told him, what was right and what was wrong, and what he had to do to make it right. And that's when he began speaking out, writing to people, letting them know that Anthony Graves was innocent.
See, I find that very interesting, because you're living in an environment where there exists a community that nobody knows anything about. They think you're all on there one to a box. And they don't understand that you have communities of people.
Well, actually, this was at the Ellis unit. This was at the Ellis.
Well, I know.
When we were in the garment factory.
Yeah, yeah. When you had the work program.
Yeah, yeah.
See, I was around with Billy Hughes to start that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, Wayne Scott was the sergeant on death row.
Right.
He started this guy, and then he went on to become director of prisons and chair of the parole board.
Yeah, yeah. So back then, we could congregate, get together, and have little, group, meetings, Bible studies and stuff.
And that's kind of physically not allowed anymore?
No, that's not allowed anymore. Now we're just isolating these cells.
But you still are able to communicate.
Well, we can holler out the side of the door, and,
It gets to be chaotic.
Yeah.
Everybody's hollering at the same time.
Correct. Yeah, but it's not the same, when you can sit there and, without barriers and communicate with somebody, and just,
Gustavo, we have almost burned up 20 minutes.
Is that correct?
Time
wow.
has been my, I've gotten the 5-minute warning. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to try to get out of the way and let you talk to this audience. They don't understand. And there's nothing you can say to help them to understand, because I think it's not understandable. But I'm going to give you a chance to do that.
Right.
The camera behind me.
Well, all I can say is that, everybody has to take responsibility for their lives, for their actions. I don't hold anybody else responsible, my past, my upbringing, nobody else. I take full responsibility for my life. I'm not saying I'm guilty of capital murder. Not innocent by any means of, I've led a troubled life, but I've taken responsibility for myself, and I've tried to become a better person every day. I've strived to become a better person, and I can say that today I'm not the same person that I was when I was arrested. The death penalty serves no purpose. Probably be executed, more than likely. The injustices, the errors that have occurred in my case are numerous. I won't get into it, but the system is flawed, and it's broken, and when I was sentenced to die, I was told that I was unrehabilitatable. And I can say that in the 25 years that I've been on death row, I've never hurt another person, another inmate, a guard. I've never assaulted anybody. The most I've done is probably killed a fly. And, the judgment that I was unrehabilitatable, I've gained a GED, a certified paralegal. I've educated myself as much as I've been able to in here. And I'm spiritually saved. I believe in God. I believe that I will be saved. And And all I can say is that, you know, the system is broken.
Gustavo, I'm glad to be your friend.
Yeah.
I will do everything that I can so that people will remember your wisdom and your maturity.
Right.
Thank you.
Yeah, I say it was nice to meet you. Finally meet the famous Ray Hill. Yeah.
I don't feel as famous right now. Yeah. But the deal is I need you, let's end the interview.
Right.
I need you to say that we have your permission to broadcast this film.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, without a doubt, or I wouldn't have come out here, right?
While you were listening to Gustavo, the state of Texas killed him. I've been informed by Pat that the witnesses have crossed the road and the procedure is complete. Pat, are you there?
Yes, I am. As you were saying, the witnesses have left the building and the family is gathering themselves to go back to the hospitality house so they can rush to the small church and be able to touch Gus after nearly 25 years.
Tell us about that, Pat.
Well, this will be the only time that any of his family, especially his mother, has been able to hug him, and they can only hug him in death. He will be taken straight from the walls unit to the small church, and he will still be on a gurney, and he will lay there, and they allow the family to come in and spend 30 or 35 minutes with him.
Well, there's still warmth in his body.
There is still warmth in his body, and that's why we never try to talk to the family afterwards, because they only have one mindset, and that is to get to their loved one, to touch him and hug him and kiss him.
Thank you, Pat. I really appreciate what you do.
We'll see you, unfortunately, I believe, on the 9th for Elvis.
Yeah.
Okay. See you then. Bye-bye.
Thank you, ma'am. That was Pat Hartwell doing the tough work of being KPFT's Execution Watch reporter in Huntsville. You heard him. I haven't anything to say about that. That was pretty clear. Hey, Mike. What's going on?
Very touching interview. Man seems to have grown up a lot in prison.
Whatever growing up he did it there.
It's funny. The issue that I'm going to talk about is future dangerousness.
Yeah.
As we heard from Jack, that his original case was reversed because what they brought into the hearing for future dangerousness is race. One thing that wasn't mentioned that we need to talk about a little bit is the difference between Hispanic and Argentinian. The doctor who testified made an issue that Hispanic men have a higher rate of coming back to prison. The question become is, since his family is from Argentina, is he not Hispanic? I do not know the answer to that question. But that was an issue to it. More importantly, what you have is, when you have somebody that young, and understand what he did was brutal murders. No question about it.
It's not pretty cases.
But you're not executed for the crime you committed. That's life in prison. You're executed for your future dangerousness. When you're so young, you don't have a track record to show your future dangerousness. He was barely 18 years old.
Well, Mike, isn't this really about emotions?
Emotions for the actual crime that's committed.
I mean, they show the jury the gory pictures of gunshot wounds to the back of the head.
But that's not what the law says.
I know, but that's how it works.
That's how it works, because it's human nature. But for the question of future dangerousness, that's the question of, what do we do with this person? The theory, of course, is that you give him life in prison, he could be a danger to other people in the prison system. So the concept is, if you keep him alive, he could hurt somebody else. That's why this issue becomes important. What's interesting here is, I don't see anything in his record to show future dangerousness, except for the crimes that got him life in prison.
Well, there was that escape attempt.
Well, that's what we're going to talk about now, okay. Because that's what happened.
Because I was in Huntsville when Gurley escaped.
Well, it's interesting. If he hadn't tried to escape, what would have happened at the second trial?
Now, he didn't make it over the wall.
I understand that. But without
made it to the fence, but not over.
What evidence do they have of him being a future danger? What they're using is the escape is that he's still breaking the law, even though he's in prison. And during that escape, somebody else died. The funny thing about it is technically that escape is also a capital crime because somebody died during the commission of a felony.
Yeah, he would be a par law party.
So technically, he's being executed not on his future dangerousness, but because he tried to escape from being murdered by the state, and that led to an accidental death, and that made him dangerous. What I find interesting is that what he did as a young man was horrible. But I got to tell you, I've got personal friends who went to Vietnam at the same age did just horrible
people.
Things.
Yeah, sure.
I have family members.
Well, I was in Vietnam '67. It's long before that.
I know judges, old district court judges, are no longer here. That during World War II, at 17 or 18, they were doing horrible things
and expected to.
But we never looked at their future dangerousness. If you look at the acts they did, in an abstract, you could say somebody who did those horrific acts would be a future dangerousness. But history showed they weren't. So because of the acts that he did, that was horrific, they tend that to make it a death penalty case. What I find interesting is if he hadn't escaped or tried to escape, would the whole result been different? Because I don't see any evidence they had of future dangerousness to him, except the escape.
Mike, would you trade places so I can get Gandalf back in here?
Oh.
I need a wizard, and I need a wizard, and
I'm the designated
you're the,
wizard.
You're the Gandalf. okay. Yeah, that's not a bad role for you. We got bushy eyebrows. Jim, the discussion tonight has led to several things, and it falls in different ground since Scalia died. Suddenly, there's some shift in the Supreme Court of the United States. We've got Kennedy, one of the so-called conservative judges, wavering on the issue of death penalty. And we've got this case where any objective look from here would be that the future dangerousness argument probably don't hold water. Looked on from the other end, apparently the jury said there was a lot of water there, but looked at it from this end back, it seems a lot different. What are the indications? Is there an indication that there's going to be some change here?
I think there probably will be, but I don't think it's for the... I think they're going to quit doing it because it's expensive. I don't think they're going to do it because of moral reasons. But again, we talked about this before. The case that really messed up capital murder was Larry O'Brien, the candy killer, who had never had a problem in his life ever with the law, and he got the death penalty to kill his own child. And what they said in that case and what they said in this case over and over again, you can take the acts he committed, and by using those acts, you can project to be a danger to the future because somebody who would shoot two clerks point blank at the back of the head, chase one down and kill him, somebody who would do that would likely do it again. And that's what really messed things up because back when they said you could use the acts itself, because think about it for a moment. Death penalty is guaranteed. Back then, there were two issues. Was it deliberate? Well, they just got through finding guilty of intentionally killing somebody. The deliberate's an automatic yes. And then if you can use the facts of the case itself to say that he's going to be a future danger because you're only going to seek the death penalty in horrific cases anyways. The facts will always be horrific. That's an automatic death penalty. And that's what makes it, this case is real difficult because I think our special issues are designed to kill people. And I think the procedure set up is designed to get the death penalty.
Well, certainly as defined after the Candyman.
Yes, because in this case—
That was a shift in definition.
Yes, and I was just—because everybody was convinced when he went up on appeal, and Davis wrote the opinion, Marvin Teague tried it, everybody was convinced they would reverse the case because there's no evidence of him being a danger to the future.
Yeah.
And the truth of the matter is he wasn't going to get out and kill another kid. I mean, that's just stupid. But yet they said you can take the act, and basically it's revenge. You can take the act that he did, if it's so horrific, you can project that to believe in future dangerousness. That's exactly what they did in this particular case. And the cherry on top of the cupcake was the escape. and another death associated with it, although it was accidental. The other inmate that was killed was drowned because he drowned in the Trinity River.
Yeah, I was there. Yeah, right. Me and Amy Goodman was in Huntsville when that happened.
And so that's cheer on top of the cake, because here he is, killed two people, was involved in an attempt to escape, which one guy dies from drowned, from drowning. And so that was a cherry on the cake, and that's why on the second case, I think for certain he would have gotten the death penalty. But since they've had that silly idea that you can project his conduct based upon the innocent evidence brought to guilt or innocence, that really guaranteed that virtually any case like this would be get the death penalty.
Well, you know, one other thing about Antonin Scalia. And, you know, Antonin Scalia voted for Hill in Hill versus Houston, against the city of Houston. Two cops I called a name unbecoming of their relationship with their mothers. And he said, well, you ought to be off the hook for that, because everybody knows about cops and their mamas. And I was proud to get his vote. So he would come up with some odd things. But he's had, in the last few years, since he's got older and more cantankerous, the ability to be a little bit clairvoyant. When they handed down the Lawrence decision, he said, next thing you know, there will be gay marriage. Well, guess what? We hadn't thought about that before, but after he mentioned it, we went to work on that, and now there's same-gender marriage all over the country, and Supreme Court made that happen. And then one of the last speeches he gave, some student asked him, well, what's the future of the death penalty? And he said, I don't think we're going to have it much longer. I think the way the court's going is that they're going to find a way to make it a negative ruling on capital punishment altogether. So maybe the mysterious clairvoyance of Antonin Scalia gives us some hope.
Well, I think so. I think it's also a couple of two things. There have been so many exonerations on death row, plus the expense, I think, is going to spell the end of the death penalty.
And explain that. Why is killing somebody more expensive than sending them to prison?
Good example. Waller County, north of here, found out what it costs to appoint lawyers to do a capital murder case, what it costs to appoint lawyers on a direct appeal. They say for that kind of money, we can buy a new maintainer. Forget the death penalty, we want a maintainer. It's extremely expensive to the county to afford.
Well, the farmers were complaining about the roads.
Right. And so it's much more expensive to take a case up on trial when the death penalty is involved, because the trials last much longer.
Yeah.
And so it's much more expensive. You're talking about spending at least $100,000 to $150,000 minimum.
Just to try the case.
Just to try the case, not counting the appeals. And I think that, plus the fact we've exonerated people because of DNA punt and DNA testing, it's going to spell the end to it. Not because I think society is, and I think society is kind of getting the idea that this is.
You're kind of resigning
themselves.
It's not an active direction they want to go, but
yeah.
let's accept reality. Or
being drug in like a noisy mother-in-law. So.
Well, Jim, I can always count on you. Thank you very much.
Larry over here, too.
Oh, Larry. Okay.
If you don't get to me, it's fine.
Okay, well, Larry, no. If you got a piece of this puzzle, we'd be more than glad to take it. I just wanted to discuss executions there for a minute.
Okay. And I know time is short, Ray, but I was going to talk about the issue of the confession.
Yeah.
Garcia did confess.
Yeah.
And that confession was used in evidence against him.
Yeah, of course.
Now, without the confession, would he have been executed? I don't know. But it's a pretty good case even without. Yeah. But in our justice system, Ray, we don't allow people's statements against their interest to be introduced in evidence against them unless there's some sort of a showing that the statement is voluntary. So oftentimes people get arrested and they just make excited statements. Oh, yeah, I did it. So clearly if somebody just
well,
volunteers.
He didn't back it down from his responsibility in this interview.
Well, if somebody says, I'm talking about the use of the confession in trial against him.
Yeah.
Because there was some question as to whether it was voluntary. Now, if a person volunteers a statement, clearly that's voluntary. But if a person is in custody and they're being interrogated, then that raises the issue, well, if you answer the question, is that voluntary or not? Mm-hmm. So we have rules to show that the statement is voluntary. There's normally generally refer to the Miranda warnings. And our Code of Criminal Procedure 3822 talks about how you go about assuring that the statement is voluntary. And that's the warning saying you have the right to remain silent and so forth. We're familiar with them. Well, once those warnings are given and understood, then there's a further showing that you have to waive the right against self-incrimination, saying, I knowingly give this right up.
Okay.
In this case, Garcia didn't do that in writing. He didn't do it in writing, and his lawyers filed a motion to suppress evidence. It came in, so on the appeal that the Court of Criminal Appeals, the appeals court says, wait a minute, when you look at the statute and you look at the failure to give an express written waiver, then the confession should not have come in. But then on rehearing, the court says, wait a minute, it's kind of a close case. It wasn't, but they said it was.
Yeah.
And when you look at the totality of the circumstances, if he understood what his rights were, and then he went ahead and gave a statement, then we're going to imply that the statement was voluntary. Okay, and there's nothing in the statute that allows for that. So the court really just rewrote the statute. And when the court rewrote the statute, that issue was raised on rehearing, and then but that's the Texas statute.
Yeah.
And so once the court reversed itself and said it's coming in, then there was nothing to be done on the federal level because it's a Texas statute, and it did not violate the Constitution because it was Texas law. So it did come in.
Thank you, Larry. Appreciate it. I want to thank the staff here because let me tell you. Getting these lawyers in here to do this, and this is all volunteer work that they do. Our legal staff is Jim Skelton, who I call Gandalf tonight, and I'll probably get away with that. I don't think it'd be too mean on me, and because he does bring a lot of wisdom to the table. Larry Douglas has got that wonderful voice, and Mike Gillespie. You know, Mike is so enthusiastic about what he's doing in this case. You can hear it in his voice. And Jack Lee has got a clarity about him. He ain't no liberal pushover. He comes in and it's all heart. And Paige has just joined us, and she's having a wonderful time here participating. Well, actually, none of us are having a wonderful time because this is about execution. A man's dead. And while he was talking to you, he died tonight. The state killed him. Pat Harwell is a real believer. She's up there. I don't care how cold or wet it is. She's in front of Huntsville doing it. David Atwood is out there on the street corner with signs hoping to convince or convert somebody passing by. We're going to have another scheduled execution on March the 9th, and it's going to be Coy Westerbrook. He was interviewed for this show as well. The person that interviewed him was Jim Skelton, and I'm looking forward to that show, if for no other reason, to see how that works. I might take a day off sometimes because of it. Otis McClay is their technical wizard. Elizabeth Stein, who's got the evening off this evening, is our producer. We couldn't do this without Elizabeth's work. Bob Gardner engineered for us tonight, and Victoria Panetti is going to do this in a couple of weeks. On hmsnetradio.org, you will be able to see a video of this show and the interview with Gus. I want to encourage you to do that. If you'll follow us on our Facebook page, we'll make plenty of notifications of the schedule for that broadcast, and you, of course, can get it off the Internet when it's being broadcast at Houston Media Source here in Houston. My name is Ray Hill. It's been Execution Watch. In memory of Gus Garcia. Good night.